Thank you very much. Michal asked me to give a lecture here, and I'm not sure that the lecture is very appropriate, but what I've thought to do is actually to tell you a little bit about my work and about the way that I see economic theory in general, and especially modeling bound rationality. Let me, first of all, as a sort of introduction, let me explain. I have the feeling that, I don't know you personally, but I have the feeling that many of you think about very practical questions. And let me, from the beginning, say I have never done anything practical in my life. I don't want to do anything practical in my life. I don't take care that other people do, but I don't have any pretension or unpretension, whatever. There is no connection between what I'm going to talk with anything practical. The way that I see economic theory in general, and I'm sure that most people disagree with me, that's fine. Economic theory for me is a collection of stories, fables, or whatever. And actually, I'm a frustrated writer. I wanted to write stories, and the most that I can do is tell some stories which are not very interesting. But that's the only thing that I know to do. And so the model is a story. I'm saying it because, you understand why I'm saying it. So what do we do in economic theory? As I've said, to my understanding, we tell stories, and the stories demonstrate why people tell stories in general. They want to demonstrate something. They want to demonstrate something, and they want to transfer some message or some understanding of some situation or insight about human beings, and that's basically what we do, I think, in economic theory. In particular, to demonstrate it, I chose a paper which personally I like most from the bunch of papers that I've written in the last few years on this subject, and it was published a few years ago, but still I love it, so I will tell you about this story. That's all. So if there is any purpose to this story, is to demonstrate a point that in economic theory is quite important or very common, which is the following. There are many models in economic theory that are supposed to explain phenomena of separation. Somebody may be a government, maybe a firm, maybe an individual, maybe society at large, wants to separate between group of people, and there is a problem that there is a lack of knowledge about who is good or who is bad. And so with economic theory, we think about institutions that are supposed to do it, or at least there is some rationale to their existence from this point of view. The most famous one is probably the Spence model. And the Spence model, for those of you who are not economists, basically the idea is that let's assume that education is not useful and it does not contribute anything to the GNP. But it is there is at least one objective to education, which is that's what Spence explains, which is it might be a way to separate between the people who are more productive and people who are less productive, assuming that there is some correlation or strong correlation between being born productive and easiness to get a degree, then the reason that we have degrees and the higher education is to do this separation between the people who are more highly educated, more able, more productive, and therefore it's worth to pay them more to work in my firm than people for which it's more difficult, and therefore they will not take the degree. Although in principle, if they would make large effort, probably they will do it. So that's a very common theme in economics, and from this point of view, I think that what we did here is basically the following: we want to demonstrate that there is probably a possibility. There is some logic or possibility to think about institutions which separate between people, not because they differ in their IQ or their cognitive power, but because of something, and that will be demonstrated in the next few minutes, because of something in the procedure of choice that maybe that some of them sometimes, not very often, sometimes use. So I will explain, and this will be immediately in the introduction. Let me just say in the beginning that actually most of my lecture here is an outcome of a joint paper with Jacob Kobi Glaser. He's also from Tel Aviv University. That's the guy, and that's a guy, that's a picture that took of him in our lab, namely, of course, a cafe in Tel Aviv. And that's actually the real place where some of the ideas of this paper were born. The cafe does not exist, but. Let me tell you about, demonstrate a sort of introduction to, through the motivation or the idea of the paper through two scenarios. Scenario A is the following, actually that's a real email that I got from a guy, very intelligent guy with the name MR, who read the paper a few years ago. He was visiting Tel Aviv, and as you visitors here, young visitors here, I'm sure are aware that Tel Aviv is very strong in not only in cafes, but many in bars. So he went to a bar, and that's the story that he wrote me. I went to a bar and was told it was full. I asked the bar hostess what time one should arrive in order to get in. I was told by 12, midnight. And once the bar is full, you can only get in if you are meeting a friend who is already inside. I lied that my friend was already inside without being told. I would not have known which of the possible lies to tell in order to get in. Basically, the paper is about that. Almost not exactly. So what is the situation here? The structure of this situation is the following. There is MR, he wants to get into the bar independently of the truth. Independently of, his task in Tel Aviv is to go to a bar. There is an hostess in the bar, and she, or the owner of the bar, decided that there is some criteria to get to the bar after midnight, and the criteria is that you should have a friend inside. Now, because of some reasons, probably legal, institutional, whatever, they can, you know, in bars sometimes they say in, out, in, out, in, out, the selectors, but in this case, she has to announce the rule. She cannot just say you in, you are out. And she announced the rule. And the rule is whatever it's written here. MR, as I've said, is a very intelligent guy. He has heard the rules, and he was able to solve the puzzle or the riddle. And the riddle was, what should he say in order to get in? So if you are told that you should say that you have somebody inside, and if there is no possibility of verification, and those of you who have been in bars know that I've not been in bars for years, but I'm sure that's the case, that there is no possibility to verify anything in a bar in Tel Aviv after midnight, then what he had to do is to say one thing, which is he has to say that he has a friend inside. That's what he did. He was successful, he had a good time in the bar and wrote me the email. That's the structure. In this sense, actually, the bar owner or the hostess failed. She wanted to separate, and she did not succeed because the procedure actually did not allow her this procedure of his possibility to solve such riddles did not allow her to distinguish between people who have friend inside and people who don't have friend inside. Okay. Scenario A. Scenario B is not true. It's something that we invented. And here is the story. As a part of the search process for a candidate for a job, a principal or an employer wishes to identify those individuals whose preference over the set of objects ABC is transitive. The story here, if you want, there is a guy in Berkeley with name Shachar Kariv. He and his collaborators conduct a very intensive work in a survey in Holland for many years, so several years, and he proved, or at least he claims that he proved. I don't think that economists prove anything. So at least they claim that he claims that actually being transitive is a good thing. Namely, you are more successful in life if you are transitive. So some people take it so seriously that they decided to check whether you're transitive or not. If you're transitive, you get the job. If you're not transitive, you don't get the job. So that's the logic behind this scenario. Okay. So the outcome is that each individual has to answer three questions of the form: how do you compare objects X and Y? And the answers that you can give are only, you cannot say you are indifferent, you don't know. You must say that you prefer A to B, or X to Y, or Y to X. That's the only two options. So in this case, there are three questions. But again, because of legal reasons or whatever, you cannot just ask the questions. You have also to announce what is the target or what is the criteria that you will use to decide whether your response gives you guarantees you the job or not. And here comes what we call a codex. I'm not sure it's a good word, but in a case, that's the term that we use in the paper. And here is the codex that, again, these are the rules that each candidate gets on the form. Namely, they do know that if you answer that you prefer A to B, and if you answer that you prefer B to C, and you don't answer that you prefer A to C, you are out. So you have to satisfy all the four rules in order to pass the test. Okay? of course. So, in this group, I don't have to explain what is the meaning of R1 to R4. Even more intelligent than, more or less the same. Let's say MR is very intelligent. Actually, he almost finished a PhD in mathematics. And not because he could not pass it, but because he preferred economics. So in any case, you see it. Look at it for a second. Think about it. By the way, think about it that you get to answer it in few. You have also some time limit, of course. If it's very important, you have a few days to think about it. Everybody will ask his friend, but think about it that you have also time limit. And now, what do you do if you have to solve a problem like that? Some of you, actually, many of you, responded to the questionnaire that I asked you yesterday to respond. So you have seen it, and probably you are trained already in questions like that. And here are some possibilities. So here is the clever man on the right. Ignore the bottom. Here the clever letter. Let's say that his true preference is he prefers B to A to C. So he's a good guy. He's a good guy. I want him in. Now, this good guy, our assumption is going to be that what he is doing, the procedure that he is using, is that he checks whether the truth satisfies the codex. Assumption, we start thinking from the truth, and if we don't have to lie, we don't lie. In this case, BAC satisfies the codex, the four rules. Let me, in this point, just to make sure that we understand the meaning in human beings' words of R1 to R4 is the following. R1 and R2 means that your answer should be transitive or exhibit transitivity, and R3 and R4 means that B should not be in the middle. Either A should be in the middle or C, A or C should be in the middle. If A is on top, then C should be above B. If C is on top, then A should be above B. So B should not be in the middle. That's clear. So that's the meaning. But of course, this meaning is not given to the subject, to the candidate. So what does he do? So again, our assumption in this paper is that in this case, he just tells the truth. He checks that actually the codex, that is the truth satisfies the codex, and he tells the truth, and he is in. Now, take this guy. He's also a good guy, right? But he, of course, he does not, he prefer A to B, B to C, and A to C. He satisfies R1, R2, and R4. He does not satisfy R3. And now the question, again, so what does he do? Our assumption is that he starts with the truth. He realizes that R3 is not satisfied. And now our assumption is that he tries something else. Remember again, think about it, that he has a time limit. He doesn't, of course, and he's not very, very quick. So he tries something else. And what does he try? Our assumption is that if one of the sentences of the if-then is not true, he tries to keep the if, but only change the then. He keeps the antecedent, but he corrects the consequence. So he will try, instead of ABC, he will try ACB. Now, of course, if he tries ACB, then we understand that if he answers A prefer A to C, C to B, and A to B, that we understand that it satisfies the codex and he is in. So this good guy, if indeed he's using this procedure that we are assuming, he will solve the riddle and he will find an answer that will pass the test. On the other hand, here is a bad guy. He has a cycle. I don't want him in. Now, of course, if he is using another procedure, he might solve it. But if he is using the procedure that I just described, namely, first of all, he checks that the truth is not satisfied. And second, he's trying to correct the truth by being guided by keeping the antecedent and changing the consequent of sentences which are not satisfied, then he will reach the I prefer A to B to C. And we have seen already that this is, of course, does not satisfy the codex. If in this case, actually, he does not have any other int, because that's actually the only rule in the codex, the only sentence in the codex, that the truth about him is not satisfied, and therefore he does not know what to do, and he gives up. That is our assumption. So to be more, it's not completely formal, but semi-formal, the procedure that we are assuming. So what's the problem? The problem is that we are asking ourselves, now we have to tell a story, want to tell a story about what people do when they have to solve riddles of this type, namely a riddle of this type, namely some set of sentences of the type if then, and they have to tell a story such that they will satisfy all the propositions in the set of the propositions, and then and the codex, and then the question, what do they do? Our assumption is that they follow, and let me say, it's an extremely strong assumption. I don't think that very many people will use this particular exact procedure, but in the last 10 minutes of the talk, I will give you some evidence to that I think gives some reason to think that it's not completely crazy only in the heads of Kobe Glaser and me. Namely, there is some grain of truth to this. At least some elements of these procedures have some traces in experimental work. So the procedure is examined. First of all, you have to tell a story. First of all, you try to say the truth. I guess that any criminal will tell you that. If you succeed, then you're happy, get the job or whatever. If not, go to step two. And step two, you try to lie. But you don't try all possible lies. You try only the lies that you get some guide by the codex. Namely, if you fail the codex, namely a sentence of the type if then is not satisfied, then our assumption is that you change your story, you change the profile, you change your story of life such that you keep the details in the if true, but you change the then such that it will be consistent with the codex. If you succeed, you are happy. If not, you try again. You try again, but every time, so we assume, you go back to the truth. So truth, try, trial, truth, trial, always going back to the truth, and then until you are exploiting the possibilities that the codex allows you to move from the truth to some other stories, and if you fail, then this is step three, you are exhausted and unhappily, you declare the truth, or you just give up and go home. That's basically the procedure that we assume. Now, we can think about, that's the example of a model of bounded rationality. Any model of bounded rationality, my definition of model of bounded rationality is that it's a model which refers explicitly to procedural aspect of decision making. And of course, we can think about it models or some procedure we can insert into many models. Here, because of some personal interest of Kobe and me, we are within what is called in the implementation literature. The standard approach in the implementation literature, as you know, that cheating is easy and costless, but as you know, there are some alternative approaches that cheating is probably costly or it's limited. I'm sure that that's something that you guys are working on, and there are some work in economics, including ours in the past, that were dealing with this sort of limitation as well. Our approach here is that the ability to cheat effectively depends on the way that the mechanism is constructed and framed, and as I will demonstrate in a second. In particular, within implementation, we talk about what is called in economics persuasion situation. Persuasion situation, this is sort of a business school type of slide, I apologize. So that's a persuasion situation. That's the speaker, she is the listener. His interests are very clear. He wants to get into the United States independently of the truth. She or the United States of America or whatever wants him in under some circumstances and not under other. Now, of course, this is a situation with a lot of verification, but of course, always there is also a margin without verification. He says something and she can just rely on what he says. Situation like that where in economics or in applied game theory were discussed in several ways. Actually, most of the literature in this context is treating this situation as a game. Although I was working a lot in game theory, actually I'm trying to work in this sort of thing, not within game theory, and this is actually, formally it's a game, but it's not really a game. Namely, we analyze it as a leader-follower scenario. Namely, our assumption is that the leader the hostess in the bar, or the immigration authorities in the United States, first of all, are the principal. Namely, they announce the rules. Why do they announce the rules? Because they have to announce the rules, or because they want to announce the rule. It cannot be arbitrary. And so it announces the rules. It's commit to the persuasion rules, namely, under what circumstances I will be persuaded by what you are going to say. Then the speaker announces the profile. Profile means here the story of your life, as I ask you. And third, then the listener in stage three is not a player. He just applies the persuasion rules that he announced here. Now, notice that if with full rationality, this problem is completely stupid, because, of course, the speaker is able to solve the codex, to solve the riddle, whatever complexity of the codex, of the riddle, and then he always, whoever the speaker is, he will get into the United States or get to the bar. More or less the same. However, of course, the small problem that makes all the interest of this problem is that the speaker is boundedly rational, and therefore, and now the point is, we are going to demonstrate that the bounded rationality actually allows us to do the separation between the good and the bad guys. Okay, yeah.
So the codex that you sent us by email, you don't consider that a small codex? I mean, there are only 8 possible answers.
What do you mean a small codex?
So you said that the problem is with...
No, small problem I meant, no, sorry. So that's probably a bad translation from Hebrew. Well, I mean, a small problem, it's not a small problem, it's that it's a small, that it's a small problem, it's... בעקטנה, איך אומרים בעברית בעקטנה? באנגלית בעקטנה?
Small problem.
Small problem. So that's disrespect.
If you put a smiley there, that would be the
problem. Yeah, no, I know. The problem with the email had 8 possible answers.
So. Yeah, we'll come to this, don't worry. But in any case, it's not connected with the small problem. The small problem is that the speaker is bounded rational, either because he cannot solve such problems, probably larger, or because he has time pressure. And by the way, even some of you guys did not answer correctly. So, but not many, actually, most of you. The model. So here I guess I can do very quickly the model, but please ask me about it. The model is not very standard in economics, but I guess for you guys it would be extremely standard. there is a set of propositional variables. The interpretation in economics of these propositional variables will be, these are the relevant facts to the situation. I'm a professor in Tel Aviv or not, I'm bald or not, I have glasses or not, this is what is relevant to the situation. What is a profile? It's the assignment of each of truth to each of the variables. And here we assume that all profiles are possible. Of course, this is a restriction about the meaning of the propositions. We don't treat the possibilities as V1 is the question whether you are a male and V2 is whether you are a female. So all the variables are independent, and we assume that all 2 to the power k profiles are feasible. What is a codex? A codex in general, it would be a set of propositions and propositional logic that uses only variables in this set. And the interpretation of announcing a codex is that your answer, the questionnaire will be, are you V1, are you V2, are you V3, are you VK? And your answer to this questionnaire has to be such that the codex is satisfied in order to pass to pass the test or to persuade the listener. You see, for economists, I'm writing in it this way, that the profile does not violate any of the rules, persuades in the listener, and you understand why I do it in this way. Now we are assuming in the paper, we are assuming 2 restrictions about the structure of the codexes. One is about what are the propositions that we allow. And we allow, in this paper, we allow only propositions of the type of this type. Namely, it must be implications of conjunction of verbals or negation of verbals that implies something about a negation, affirmative or negation of another verbal. So it must be things of this type. This is not a rule. We don't allow that V1 will appear both in the antecedent and in the consequent. The second restriction is probably more problematic, and not problematic, but in the, usually when I talked about it, actually there were more questions. Like we call it coherence, and the coherence is, of course, you can accept it, you can say that it's more acceptable and less acceptable. We find it, before I say it, we find it a reasonable restriction on the set of the contexts. We don't allow codexes which includes things like that. Here I mean, it's a codex that means that if you are a professor, you should not be economist, you should be economist, and if you are a professor, you should not be economist. Of course, I understand that this is equivalent to saying that you are, should not be, you say that you are not an economist, but that's exactly what we want to prevent. Because of the MR story, we don't want actually to guide you to say what you say, what you're supposed to say, because if that's the case, then we are back to square zero. So we don't allow this. We also don't allow this because we found it not reasonable. This means something like that if you are an economist, you should be an Israeli, and if you are a professor, you should not be an Israeli in order to get into the job. And that's, of course, then I will come and say to the composer of the codex, what do you want for my life? For one side, I'm an Israeli, and so I'm V1 and I'm V2. For one side, you tell me that I should be V3. For another side, you tell me that I should not be V3. That does not sound to us reasonable if you think about it also with some load of normativeness. Therefore, we don't allow it. Of course, you can exclude it, and then the paper would be much simpler, because here we restrict ourselves that the codexes will have a structure, not only this structure, but it will have also the structure of that it will not violate the coherence. It's much easier to do whatever you want to do without the coherence. But again, I think that it's a reasonable assumption. We think that's reasonable.
Yeah. The first one is
what do you mean, this? No, not V1.
So first we're saying you have to be not V1.
It's not V1, the opposite. Yeah. What do you do? That means not... Okay, so let me repeat, I mean, at least let me repeat about the logic. You can Sergio, you promised not to speak. He told me that he's going to sleep. So that's what he does when he sleeps. Imagine what he does. When he... So this, of course, this means that it's not V1. As I said, we don't want to allow that. Here, actually, our intuition is the following. I don't like rules of the type that say if you are from Jerusalem, you should have a beard, and if you are a professor, you should not have a beard, because then you will come to me and say, "What do you want for my life? I am both V1 and V2, and not V3." Sergio. Again, it's not logic. It's a matter of taste. That's our taste. And I think that such codexes makes less sense than codexes without it. That's all.
Do you allow triplets to?
What do you mean triplets?
You say no pair of fools.
Okay. No. So the of course the exact definition here is that should not be two rules in the codex such that the antecedents are not conflicting, and the consequences are contradicting. That's the generalization of that's actually the exact definition. Okay, that's the rule. Now you feel better? Okay. Okay, now, So, another question, how to formulate the procedure. And the procedure we formulate through the following. Given lambda, lambda is the codex, is the set of proposition. Then we define the concept, the speaker is guided from S to S prime. So S is the truth, and S prime is something that you will try, given the codex. When will you try S prime if the truth about is S? Let me start here with the idea. The idea is that any change from S to S prime, you change some of the bits, some of the values. Any change from V, we do allow here that you will change. In the example that I started with, we allowed only, we talk only about changing one value. In general, we do allow also that you change simultaneously more than one value from what the truth is to what you try as a solution. But any of the changes should be justified by some rule that give you the idea to make this change and relies only on the variables that you don't change. Example. So if this is the codex and the truth is 1111, then you are guided to all these objects. Of course, degenerate case, but let's talk about these two cases. So why are you guided to 1101? Because V1 implies not V3, gives you the idea to change V3 from 1 to 0. Of course, the same is true here, and here you're changing simultaneously both V3 and V4, because actually by keeping V1 and V2, the truth is 1111. You don't change V1 and V2, but simultaneously it gives you the idea to change both the value of V3 and V4. Therefore, we do allow that you are trying also the 1100. Okay? Of course, the formal definition is just a generalization of this idea. Okay, so that's actually the component of the, that's the main component of the procedure. What is the set of the solutions that you try? And again, the idea is that you try only candidates that you get, you're guided by the codex itself to try. And the main definitions is A is implementable. What is A? Sorry, I forgot to mention something. There is a set of profiles. A is the set, the target of the listener or the target of the designer is to separate between the good guys and the bad guy. The good guys, the symbol here is A for acceptance, and R, the residual set for rejection. So we will say, now we will say that A is implementable if, given this procedure, of course, even if there is lambda, namely there is a codex, such that the good guys are guided to a profile in T of lambda. T of lambda is the set of solutions of the codex lambda, and the bad guys are not. That's the definition of implementation. I can find a codex that will separate between the good and the bad. Truthful implementation is that there is a codex such that the good guys don't have to cheat. The bad guys, even if they try to cheat, don't pass the test. That's the main definitions. Of course, again, the formalization is not very important, but that's really the definition. Let me just give you two examples, just to make sure that we understand both the procedure and also the deficiencies of the definitions. So that's the case there are three variables. And the good guys are the guys which are decisive. I don't like people that sometimes are right wing, sometimes left wing. I want only people who are decisive, either right or left, 1-1-1 or 0-0-0. Okay. Now the codex. Look at the left codex. The left codex is look at that here. Of course, that codex is very bad. The solutions of this codex are only the good guys, the 1-1-1 and the 0-0-0. But the problem is, of course, in this case, everybody is guided to the truth. For example, 1-0-0. 1-0-0 is guided by these two sentences that is guided to 1-1-1. The zeros are guided by these two sentences, so everybody is guided to a solution, and therefore this is a very bad codex. This is a little bit better. This is a little bit better because, and of course, the meaning, by the way, here, of course, in words, it means that your answer to the second and third question should be like the answer to the first. Here, the interpretation is that the answer to the second question should be like the first, the third should be like the second. Under our assumption, this will be a little bit better codex because the 110 still is guided to 111, for example, by this implication. However, these two guys are not. Y00 is guided only to 110. Now, of course, if he would follow a procedure such that if he is guided to 110, then he continues the chain, then he would be guided to 111. But as I say, the particular procedure that we study in this paper is that I move, go back. I move, go back. I'm so nervous to keep I try to create an alibi, but I'm very much afraid that alibi will be problematic. So all the time I'm sticking to the truth, which I know, which is the truth about me, and therefore I try and I move. I try and I go back. That's the logic or that's the rationale of this assumption. Of course, there is other procedures, and usually when economists ask me, when I talk about it, ask me about this procedure, I tell them another procedure, another paper, that's all. Now, can we implement this set of the 111 and 00? Yes, we can. And the reason is that here is a lambda which implements actually even truthfully the set A, and let me just show you again in this crowd I don't have to explain, but because I think that this gives a lot of hints actually to the analysis and the propositions that comes later. If we move from if we take each of the vertices, here is of course a profile, and the red are the good guys and the other are the bad guys. Then what each of these, by the way, in the paper we call it a complete rule. Complete rule is a rule which is in some sense is very unrealistic, is very bad in many respects, but nevertheless it's very useful, of course, for the proposition, for our theorems. And a complete rule is a rule that all the variables appear. All the variables in the set V appears in each of in the sentence. Now, the implication, what is the role of this such implication? The role of such implication is that it kills the 0, 1, 0. The point is, I want to kill the 0, 1, 0. I want that the two telling the truth, 0, 1, 0, will not pass the test. However, if I kill it, I give you an idea what to try. And you try, of course, so each of these sentences, complete sentences, kills one profile and also guides him to something else, in this case, to the 0, 1, 1. Now, the point here is, of course, that the structure, the geometrical structure of the bad guys is such that we can create a cycle. So what we do, by the way, the coherence means that actually I'm not allowing to go back and forth. That's actually the geometrical interpretation of the coherence. If I kill something A by guiding him to B, I cannot kill B by guiding him to A. This will contradict the coherence. So, for this set, of course, I can create a cycle that contains all the points, and therefore, and that's actually what these six rules do. Sorry? These are the bad guys. The bad points should, well, you will see in a second the generalization. But in this case, there is a cycle, so it's a circle of lies, and you cannot get out of this circle. The good guys don't have to cheat in order to pass the test. The bad guys, even if they try, and by the way, even if they try also to, if they are guided from A to B, and then even if they are guided from B to C, and they do it also, still they will not find the light. Okay? So that's a codex that implement. Example of something which cannot.
The cycle is actually stronger than what you require.
Sure, absolutely sure. You will see in a second, actually. Since the time is short, let me say, actually, one of the propositions of the paper says that this procedure that you continue and continue and continue until you fail and probably try again is equivalent to truthful implementation. But that's a result. But in any case, that's not the point of this presentation. Now, another example of something that you cannot implement and easy to see, this set. So this is a set, I like decisive people. I ask you whether you like Japanese or Chinese or Korean restaurants. I don't like the people that say that they like everything or they don't like anything or they like both and I should decide. I like only people who are decisive. They say I like only one thing and they don't like the rest. Okay? Can I implement it? Yes. No, I cannot implement it. And the reason is, of course, the following. So if you have implementation, case one, let's see, if there was a codex that would implement without the good guys having to cheat, namely a truthful implementation, then the 000, of course, it should fail. If it should fail, then it means that there must be some rule that it violates. The rules up to permutation must be either not V1 implies V3 or not V1 at end, not V2 implies V3. These are the only possibilities to kill 000. But then if this appears, this means that the 000 is guided to 001. And if we talk about implementation, truthful implementation, the 001 must be accepted, and therefore there could not be truthful implementation of this set. Now, if there was implementation which was not truthful, then it means that one of the good guys, 001, is not a solution to the codex lambda. But then I must kill him and I must also save him. How could I save him? I could save him only by guiding him to a solution. Without loss of generality, this will be the 010. So therefore, if I kill 001, I must guide him to 010. But how could I guide 001 to 010? I can guide him only by including not V1 implies V2, actually, also not V1. Also, not V1 implies not V3, must be in the codex. But if this is in the codex, this means that the 000 also is guided to the same 010 that is saving this guy, but also, unfortunately, quote unquote, saves the bad guy 000, and therefore there is no implementation to this set. Okay, so that's a simple example. By the way, in this case, you see that the bad guys have this structure, and this is again an int to the general conclusion. Now I will pass on the. I will. Yes, please.
So isn't it enough that every bad guy has a neighbor in the cube?
No, because we have to, as I said before, I probably babbled it. The killing must. Because of the coherence, if I kill it A by directing him to a neighbor, then I cannot kill the neighbor by directing to him. Now let me skip on the auxiliary result. Ultimately, let me just say that of course, if I am guiding A to B, then I'm also guiding A to any neighbor in the natural neighborhood relation of A, which is between A and B. So that's important for the continuation. And now let me just tell you about the two. I have time until 5:30. Okay. So let me tell you about the basic results without proofs, of course. Not of course, but without proofs, and proofs are on the paper. So truthful implementation. So what can we do analytically? You know, we come from an analytical tradition. Namely, it's not enough to write a model. Then we have to show that you can do something with it. So what can you do here? I think what you can do is characterize the sets A, which are truthful implementable, and the sets which are implementable, and that's exactly what we fully do in the paper. So truthful implementation, the condition here is the following. A is truthful implementable if every connected component of the bad guys has a cycle. Now, let me just explain why that's the case, because if it's truthful implementable, namely, you have to kill this guy. You have to kill him, but you cannot kill him by guiding him to a good guy, because then he will be saved. So you must be killed by actually guiding him to something else. In particular, you are guiding him also to a neighbor who must be a bad guy. And then, of course, there must be, because of the finiteness, there must be a cycle. And therefore, if you have truthful implementation, then it must be that every bad guy is connected, as in his component, connected component must include a cycle. On the other hand, if you have a cycle, then it's very easy to construct the mechanism or the codex, because and which will include only complete rules like those I described before, and that's by the following. If you have a code, if you have a cycle, then you do it like we did before, and now you go always in the direction of the cycle, and that's one way, right? If you go in the direction of the cycle, one particular cycle that you chose in the component, then this gives you the right structure. A conclusion from this condition are from. Yeah, implementation is that there is some codex such that the good guys, the bad guys will not succeed in any case. In implementation, in truthful implementation, the good guys don't cheat. They say the truth. In the implementation, cheating here is fine in this model. It's not immoral. So you're encouraged to cheat, and it's even useful in a social sense. So implementation is that every good guy, either by saying the truth or by cheating, succeeds to solve the riddle. Okay? So in the paper you will find many conclusions from this. For example, for you guys, I don't have to say it, but for example, in this case, if the set of the good guys is relatively small, namely it contains less than k minus 1 nodes, namely, k is the number of the variables, then actually the bad guys is a large set, it must be connected and it contains a cycle, and therefore if the number of good guys is relatively small, then you do have truthful implementation. Mathematically, actually, we found it not trivial to characterize the implementable sets, and the result is what is called here proposition 7. So set A is implementable if and only if every connected component of the bad guys either contains a cycle or there is a profile R in the component that is a neighbor and is the neighborhood relation. So is a neighbor of a good guy who is a neighbor to another good guy. Now, what's the problem? The problem, why it's not trivial? It's not trivial because let's say that this is a component of the bad guys that does not have a cycle. So therefore you must actually guide one of these guys to somebody. With this condition, then one of the bad guys is a neighbor who has another neighbor who is a good guy. A good guy neighbor who is another neighbor who is also a good guy. So what you want to do is to do the following. Guide this to this. But now you must kill this guy as well. So you don't have to kill him, but you must prevent him from being accepted by telling the truth. So you must save him. And the only way to save him is to send him, to guide him to another good guy who is not does not have to cheat. Now, if you can do it, then you can treat all these guys very easily because, again, this is a sort of the gate for this component, and you send the guys in the direction of the gate. What's the problem? The problem, the mathematical problem, is that if you guide this guy to this guy, you must also it must be that actually there is another component here, and you have to use this as a sort of a gate to this component, and you have to send this guy to this guy. And as I said before, we don't want this to happen because of the coherence. The coherence does not allow you to save it A by sending him to B, and to save B by sending him to A. Yeah.
I wonder, do you have any proposition that relates the implementability of the codex to its complement?
I don't recall it now. It's a few years since, but we did. It's not true.
It's not true.
It's not true. No. It's not true. Absolutely. No.
It seems strange because you would think.
Well, I don't think so. Well, it seems strange from the beginning, but when you start to think about it, it's not strange, because actually there is a sort of asymmetry.
Like excisive paper, in a sense.
Since we have only a few minutes, let me just, I would like to get to the explanation. But it's a good point. Think about it, you will see that actually it's not, it sounds natural, and that's one of the things that we tried at the beginning to see, but it's not the bad and the good guys are not symmetric here in this definition. For example, a conclusion from this is if the set of the bad guys is relatively small, then you do have implementation, but typically you would not have a truthful implementation. That will be a CPKL. Okay. Let me, for the last 5 minutes, just spend on the a little experiment, that, but let me, before, I'm not experimentalist, and I don't pretend to be experimentalist, I'm a sort of, my hobby is to do some experiments, Ido will not improve it, and the ways that I do it is terrible, I mean, these guys like Ido hates the way that I do experiments, because I don't want to pay people, and I don't put them in a lab. Everything is online without any incentives. I'm sure that that's the right way to do it, but that's for another lecture. Ido does not agree. So the little experiment is basically the experiment that you have done. Unfortunately, I discovered this morning that actually there was some typo in what you... It's fine, I mean, because actually the message was, I'm sure that you got it already, but actually it's not exactly what you will see now. So I apologize to myself, basically, that there was a mistake. That's another story. I will not tell you that now. But in essence, let me just say that the subject here were all students of classes in game theory around the world, in many, many countries, not only in the United States or in Israel, but even in China and so on. You've seen it, most of you have seen it, but let's, for in sake of those who did not have the time to do it, let me just repeat. So there were only two, let me also say that... Okay, I didn't want to say. So in any case, there are only two screens in this experiment. That's good. Subjects don't have patience. The shorter is the experiment, the better. Ido does not agree with me. In the first screen, you will ask three strange questions. Where do you go to bed? Before midnight, after midnight? I have now a lot of information about when students of game theory go to bed. To be honest, actually, one point, actually, since almost everybody went to bed after midnight, we change it to after 1 a.m. and before a.m. And then it was balanced. Which of the following you prefer, cheesecake and chocolate cake? Now, I don't know. For Kobe and me, it was very clear. I'm clearly a cheesecake guy. I think that Kobe is a chocolate cake guy. It's so clear to me. I discovered that some people don't feel that they are cheesecake or chocolate cake. It's odd for me, but, you know, there are strange people in the world. But in any case, I'll explain in a second why the questions are strange. And third, you were born on an odd day of the month or an even day of the month. Now, what was the problem? The problem is that we wanted to ask questions that people feel identified with and are not used. We don't want to use negation as a property and negation. It's an interesting property of the language that there are very few unary relations that have names both to the property and the negation. Male-female, of course, is one possibility, in most for 1 minus epsilon of the people, but it's the problem is with male-female that we were afraid that some people will not, even in a game like that, will not be able to click that their gender is different than what they are. And we wanted people to feel freely, emotionally, to cheat. But it's a property of the language that it's difficult to think about examples, and we did not want to have citizens of the U.S., non-citizens of the U.S., because we understand. So that's what we found after a lot of... consultation with some important people, but I don't know. I'm not sure that we did the best, but in any case, that's the rationale for these odd questions. But again, it's odd, but on the other hand, cheesecake and chocolate, how many people are cheesecake guys? How many chocolate guys? So most of you are fine. Okay, and then there was this terrible screen, and the story here was that you are going to get $1 million, you participate in the lottery of $1 million, of course. This is a case that I did pay money, by the way, Ido. One, of course, not 1 million, only 100. And in order to be eligible to participate, you have to answer the questions, and your answers must not violate any of the following six restrictions. And here are the six that you have seen, and here there was some mistake, but not important. What is important for me is one, you understand what's going on? So all of the six sentences are if-then sentences, and they have the same structure of what we talked about, and there are only eight profiles, as you said, and there are only two solutions, surprise, surprise, 8 - 6 = 2, and let's look at this. So now you should look down. So out of the eight, well, it's not important exactly what they are, but believe me that actually there are the following three classes. There are two profiles which are solutions. There are three profiles which are not solutions, but if people would follow our procedure, they would solve the riddle. Namely, these profiles are guided to one of the elements here. These unlucky guys are not solutions and are not guided to the truth, to solutions. So what would be a good result? A good result seems to be that everybody here will succeed, but not only will succeed, but also by telling the truth. Everybody here will succeed by not only succeed, but going to the profile that he is guided to. And everybody here should fail. If I would tell you anything like that, these results, you would know one thing, not that our theory or model is right, but that we are cheating. So we don't cheat. But on the other hand, actually, I think that this is from the work, at least experimental work that I've done, this is the best result that I've ever got, which is you summarize here. What you see here is the rate of success. The rate of success of these guys, and by the way, it's not, of course, the numbers of the subject is quite large. We talk about several hundreds, and actually we repeated on it also with other codexes. In the case for this codex, the rate of success here is 80%, 54, 36. It's not 100, 100, zeros, but it's very much in the direction. Out of the 80%, 71 of the 80, so it's 71 of the 80, I mean, that's an absolute number. So 71 succeeded, 9 failed. So 71 of the 80 succeeded by saying, being honest, 9 of the 80 succeeded by cheating. No, it's not strange because I think, let me tell you why it's not strange, because Kobe and me wasted so much time about finding solutions in these sort of things, and always, so many times we did mistakes. So many of the, part of the reason is just doing a mistake. You may be that you started with the truth, but nevertheless you saw that it's wrong, but then you found something else which is right. Okay, in general, let me say that I have the feeling that about 30%, again, not only from this, but from several experiments like that, about 30% of the people probably thought that the experiment is about being honest. And they will just say the truth. Okay, but the most interesting thing for me is this column. This column is my obsession in experiments, which is what is about response time. This is the median response time of the people who succeeded, not of people who failed, but of people who succeeded. The median response time of the people in this class who succeeded is 2 minutes. Of this class is about 2.5 minutes, and the median here is more than 5 minutes. I'm very much surprised that anybody in the world spent more than 5 minutes on this nonsense, but absolutely. So are people who make real important decisions, by the way. The real people who make really decisions about going to war and so on, you think that they are sitting near the computer and click? Yes, it's connected with... okay. absolutely. That's the real thing. Right? Absolutely. By the way, and also in laboratory, you don't know that people are really thinking. They might think about your girlfriend, about their exam, about lunch, about going to the restroom that they are prevented to go to, and so on. That's, So let me just finish and just 1 minute in your permission. Just say, actually, in this class, actually, what you see here is actually the two should be read as zero. What you see here is these are the eight profiles. This is the numbers, the absolute numbers of. This means that 29 people with the profile 112 declared 112. These are the truth tellers. So what the yellow? This means that 122 was guided to 112. What you see, so people here in the yellow. So take this for example, the 111. That's extreme positive thing case for us. 29 people succeeded. Almost all of them succeeded by going to the profile that they are guided to, and not to the other one, which is a solution and also differs only in one byte. In this case, it's less true, and here again, it's quite true. So we don't have time to talk about it, but let me say just to summarize the experiment. The experiment supports one thing, which is our two components of the procedure that I believe that are quite, have some, are not confirmed, but they have some traces in the data. Number one, people start from the truth. Number two, they tend to try more the profiles that they are guided to. Yellow from the truth. Yellow from the P. This means. She will kill me. But this means that this guy is supposed to fail, but he's guided to this. But this is not a solution. This means that there are six sentences. Each of the implications kills one of the profiles and guides him to another profile. So the yellow means this guided to this. This guided to this. No, guided is not by procedure. Guided means that there is a sentence. There is a sentence. There is an implication in the codex that you saw that kills this and send him to this. Our procedure is that the guys here, what they do, they go to what they are guided to, and they find that this is a solution. The guy here actually trying the truth and he fails. He's guided also to this and it's not a solution and he gives up. That's our procedure. Okay. Finally, these are my conclusions. That's the conclusions. That's my fight in economic theory against any conclusion sections in economic theory, which are always a bunch of nonsense. And now I'm not an angel, so usually editors require from us to write nonsense. So we wrote also some nonsense. Don't read it. I'm quite ashamed in these conclusions, but you know that's what we are required. And this is the real conclusion. That's a picture from Iceland. I did not mean it, but when I presented it, one person raised the hand and said that actually this is a good summary of the paper. It's supposed to screen between human beings and cows. Human beings could pass. And cows should not. So that's basically what the procedure does. That's the most that I can say in favor of this. But actually, the strong point, it's not connected, and this is the conclusion.